Good evening, everyone. Welcome. My name is Pascal Dumy, and I'm a graduate, 2003-2005 graduate of the School of Engineering and Applied Science, and the current chair of the Engineering Alumni Association. It's my pleasure to welcome tonight the alumni, faculty, student, and friends to the 2015 Frank Howard Distinguished Lecture Series featuring Dr. Natalia Trajanova. The Frank Howard Distinguished Lecture is an endowed lecture fund established 70 years ago by a gift from its namesake, a GW alumnus and former trustee of the university, and also the president of the Standard Oil Development Company. The lecture brings to GW outstanding leaders of science and industry, like our distinguished speaker tonight, and to discuss timely topics in engineering and allied subjects. The Frank Howard Distinguished Lecture is one of the many events we host. And so if you're interested in learning more about our events and or how to be engaged in our in the CIS community, please do not hesitate to talk to me or Bouthaina Choukri, who will pop up anytime soon after the lecture. She's the director of the CIS alumni programs. And actually, we just wanted to highlight our next event is the Pelton Senior Project Competition and Senior Alumni Barbecue, and that's on Thursday, May 14. So if you want to mark your calendars for that event. And obviously, more information can be found outside, so feel free to grab. I think there are some brochures on the registration table. And yeah, if you can save the day for it. And without further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Igor Efimov, the chair of the CIS Biomedical Engineering Department.
Thank you, Pascal. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. This is really a wonderful occasion. I'm so proud to introduce our today's speaker. But first, let me introduce myself for those who still don't know who I am. I'm the new chairman of our new Department of Biomedical Engineering. And just a very short time ago, I was inducted to endowed professorship, which was endowed by Allison and Terry Collins, and through their generosity, so our department will grow. So they also endowed scholarships for our graduate students, which is also a wonderful gift, which will allow us to grow our program in the engineering school. So this particular event was endowed by GW alumnus Frank Howard, who made this gift for inviting outstanding speakers who essentially led the field of engineering for many, many years. And today, you will see for yourself during wonderful presentation of Professor Trajanova from Hopkins, just our neighbor, how essentially new engineering solutions can completely transform, in this case, the field of biomedical engineering, but also the field of clinical engineering and clinical medicine. So it's very wonderful to follow essentially the program which was endowed by Frank Howard, which was titled Making History. And that's what we are trying to do here. And students and faculty and guests, I'm sure will learn a lot new information from today's lecture. So before I formally introduce our speaker, I would like to say a couple of anecdotes about our speaker. So many, many years ago, when I came to the United States in 1992, and I remember very well when I was a postdoc, just green off the ship. So I went to my very first conference. I remember it was in San Diego at some airport, Holiday Inn. And I went, it was an IEEE conference in biomedical engineering, and I saw this very impressive impressive group of people. So very well-dressed young woman, surrounded by huge young men who were probably at least 6'5", at least probably six of them. And they were very, very aggressively walking towards a poster session. And I followed them. I didn't know that at that time who it was. And then I saw beautiful posters in computer modeling on the subject which I was engaged in. And this was my first encounter of Professor Trajanova, who was actually at that time at Duke University. Originally, she is from Bulgaria, where she got her education. And she was trained in electrical engineering. And then after that, she came here to the United States. In physics, like me. And then she came here and worked. Her first faculty appointment was at Duke University, and then she moved to Tulane University, and that's when we became really good friends and collaborators. And we just recently counted, we spent probably close to $15 million of NIH money so far, which led to many publications, many interesting ideas, patents, and actually a couple of companies as a result of that. But basically, after Katrina, when unfortunately, as you many of you remember, was really devastating for New Orleans, and it was devastating for Tulane University, Professor Traiano's laboratory was actually out of work for 6 months. And we were so lucky to attract her to St. Louis at the time. So she spent with her group 6 months in St. Louis. For some time, they even lived in my basement because there was really nowhere to go. But basically, this was brought us even closer, and after that she moved to Johns Hopkins University, to essentially this neighborhood. And since that time, she really focused on something incredible, which is how to bring computational biophysics, computational biomedical engineering, computational cardiology from something which explains scientific facts, explains mechanisms, visualizes certain clinical phenomena, to something which is much more practical, how to take these powerful tools, combine it with clinical imaging, and make out of it a clinically relevant therapy. So, and not only clinically relevant therapy, but therapy which can be tailored to a particular patient. So essentially, she now teaches us how to use information from medical imaging from a particular patient in order to guide future therapy, therapy which is conducted by clinicians, clinical electrophysiologists, cardiologists. So, and you will see how this pipeline developed over the years. So let me introduce her formally. So she has a number of really impressive titles. So I don't have time to read all of them. I'll just mention a couple. So she was the inaugural and very first professor of Mary Sachs, professor of biomedical engineering at Johns Hopkins University. I was actually very fortunate to be present when she was inducted to this amazing professorship. And this was actually on the day when Johns Hopkins University Biomedical Engineering Department celebrated its 50th anniversary. So it's actually the oldest department in our field of biomedical engineering. More recently, she became a member of a very, very exclusive club. I believe only 10 people per year become members of this club. And this is she was a 2013 recipient of NIH Director's Pioneer Award. So it's really a very exclusive club. I just came from a study section where we reviewed a junior club, which is a new innovator award, but those are about 50 people who will receive per year. She also published more than 200 papers. So many of these papers are widely cited, so very, very influential in the field. They really transformed our field, like I already explained. So in the past, we just wrote equations to explain experimental data. So now, those amazing models which Professor Traiano will show to us teach us how to treat a particular lethal cardiac disease. And this is really amazing how we could go through essentially a lifetime of a single generation. So she is a director of a computational cardiology laboratory at Johns Hopkins University, which has trained numerous students. I know many of them, some of them are now faculty members in different places. Some are in work for government. One of her former students I just talked to, he is quite high already in the FDA structure. So he's a regulatory officer at FDA, and we actually hope to recruit him as a part-time instructor in our courses. Essentially, there are so many fields in computational cardiology her laboratory influenced that I just don't have time to go over it. But in my personal research, it was a big, big influence. And we continue to collaborate, so we have a grant right now in review. Hopefully, we'll get it funded. And also, I don't know if I can disclose it, that she's very interested in having a sabbatical here. And she wants to spend here at GW September and October of next year. So we'll have to welcome her more closely, and this will be a great opportunity for our students to collaborate with her. So welcome, Dr. Traiano.
Well, that was some introduction. Thank you, Igor. I can't tell you how thrilled I am. This is really very close to my heart. He is a very, very, very dear friend. And I was so thrilled when Igor accepted this position to be the inaugural chair of the Biomedical Engineering Department. We've always worked together and we love working together, but it is very different when you're physically close. When my lab was post-Katrina in St. Louis, it was amazing. We just sat down and wrote so many things together. So my hope is that now that Igor is here, this is gonna be a continuous, very close collaboration that me, my lab at Johns Hopkins, and our two departments will have. And this is a wonderful opportunity for me to come and tell you what we do in my lab, and also to meet many of you. I am envious of this building. It is beautiful. I love the windows and the light and everything. People who work here are really lucky to be here and to have this new building, new department. It is great to be new, to have a new opportunity. So it's, again, I'm very envious, so lucky you. So I want to talk to you today about virtual hearts. And what I mean by that is, if you look, as Igor mentioned, if you look at the contribution of computational sciences generally to engineering or physics, they have made huge contributions. Now we have cars, buildings, bridges that are built based on computations. Actually, there are cars that are not even tested. They're just built based on software. So in other words, computational sciences have made such an inroads in our daily life, but what has happened is medicine and the biology have remained sort of outside of that realm. And the reason is that it is complex and very unpredictable, but we have accumulated over the, you know, the many years, a lot of knowledge about the molecular, cellular processes, how the organs behave. So now we are able to start bringing this information within modeling and then bringing that into the clinic. So I will talk to you today about computational modeling of the heart. You'll see some pretty pictures. This is my lab. We do computational cardiology. And we have a variety of projects that I have termed virtual electrophysiology lab. So what that means is that electrophysiology is a science that deals with the electrical functioning of organs. So we will be talking about the heart specifically. So in the heart, electrical function is very important. It precedes the contraction of the heart. So if something is not okay with the electrical functioning, then the heart does not contract right. So we will be studying the electrophysiology of the heart. Now, I term this virtual electrophysiology lab. Oh, it's misspelled. It's an R there. It's a virtual electrophysiology lab because when a patient has an arrhythmia, arrhythmia is rhythm dysfunction. So the heart is not, the electrical activity in the heart is not right, and therefore the contraction is not right. When a patient goes to the hospital to be cured for arrhythmias, typically the patient goes to an electrophysiology lab. That's the clinical place where the patient is taken care of. And what we want to do is we want to build a virtual electrophysiology lab. And for us, this is a patient-specific simulation environment. It's a model and in which we incorporate functions from the molecular to the whole heart. And our first step is to use this environment for the diagnosis and treatment of heart rhythm disorders. We are starting in patients with structural disease. So these are patients who have infarct. I mean, 82% of all arrhythmias are in patients who have infarction. So we are starting with this group of people because that's where we think we can make the biggest difference. Why would this be important? What's the impact of such a bringing to the clinic such a simulation environment? We believe it will reduce the invasiveness of diagnostic procedures, substantially improve therapies, and dramatically reduce costs. So what we want to do is to have virtual heart for every patient. A patient is admitted to the clinic, a virtual heart is built of that patient heart from the scans, from the MRI or CT, whatever that is. I will show you MRI. And then with that virtual heart, the physician can play various scenarios and determine the best treatment. Also, we are developing software that can make prediction of certain therapy very easy based on a patient-specific way. Now, the reason we think this is important is because, in a way, when a patient is treated in the hospital, the physician operates from a mental model, right? They have a model of what they think the disease is, and they will say, oh, that's the best treatment. Well, medicine has gotten so complicated. So what we are doing is we are substituting a physician's mental model of the disease and the possible treatment with something very rigorous. And that would be the model of the heart of the individual patient. So that's our big vision. So that's what we want to do. So we have been working on that. And I want to show you three applications that we have made some inroads. And one is the first one. The title sounds scientific, but I'll explain what that means. Ablation targets for infarct ventricular tachycardia. So the ventricles are the bottom chambers of the heart. So they are the major pumps. And if they don't function right, then basically death ensues in up to 5 minutes, 5 to 7 minutes. So they have, this is the most important organ. And ventricular tachycardia is a very fast rhythm in the bottom chambers of the heart. And we are going to be talking about that in patients that have infarction. So these arrhythmias are very frequent in patients who develop infarct. And one of the treatments for these patients is basically the physician navigates a catheter to try to burn a piece of the heart of the patient where the physician thinks is the organizing center somehow. And then that would terminate the arrhythmia. And that's what we will be talking about here. Now, what is an arrhythmia? So this is a movie. This is actually a human heart. This is a simulation and shows a virtual human heart. And you can see in a normal heart, when an electrical wave propagates through the heart and then the heart contracts and it's very organized. Here, as you can see, we have a wavefront that goes circles on itself, like a little spiral, and stays here and never gives the chance of the heart to relax and fill with blood. So when you have a wave that circulates all the time, the heart is trying to contract right there. So now it's trying to contract following this wave. So it isn't it's not a good situation. So we need to eliminate. And as I said, the physician is going to try to find this. Unfortunately, a physician does not see that. Right? And I'll show you what they see. So, but the goal would be to find, like for instance, right here, if we burn this little piece, hopefully this arrhythmia will be terminated. Now, here is how it's done in the clinic currently. Okay? What we have here is a patient is referred for this procedure called ablation. VT stands for this fast arrhythmia in the ventricles. As I said, the catheter is navigated in the heart, and the heart electrical functioning is probed point by point. So basically, the catheter is moved from point to point to point. Actually, the physician does not see the heart. What they see is, this is like an X-ray, fluoroscopy. They see only the catheter, and they go around like that blindly and poke. And at every point, they would record an electrical activity, voltage in that place in the heart. And then they would construct a map like that. And then from that map of the voltages, they have to deduce where they have to go and burn. Okay? So that's what's done currently in the clinic. So here is a heart that has been ablated, that burns have been inflicted to terminate the arrhythmia. Now, what you see here are the dots. The dots are the tips of the catheter that delivered the burn. Now, this is not the actual burn, the actual lesion. These are only the tips of the catheter. The lesions are around it. So you can see pretty much this whole thing is a burn, it's a lesion. So this part of the heart is no longer functioning. So in an attempt to terminate the arrhythmia, a large portion of the heart is made non-functional. And that procedure has very low success rate, 51%, and lasts 4 to 12 hours. And the major time that is spent in this procedure is this interrogating, trying to figure out how does arrhythmia look like, where should we burn? That takes most of the time. And then they navigate to that supposed location with the catheter. And again, as you can see, it's very, very inaccurate. So in my lab, we have a radically different proposal, what we would like to see done. And if a patient comes, we suggest that a pre-ablation MRI is taken. An MRI is anyway is done in many patients. And then you can see here, this is dead tissue, the infarct. So we do image processing, segment out what is healthy myocardium, what is deep scar, which is connective tissue, and then there is this sort of a semi-remodeled, semi-viable tissue that surrounds the infarct, injured, but still functioning. So we segment these three regions, and then we construct a patient-specific model of the heart. Here it is. And then we evaluate all the possible arrhythmias that can arise in this patient based on this scar distribution. And then we find what is the most optimal way to burn. Was it one burn, maybe two, but what is the minimum size of the burn and the most precise to terminate that arrhythmia? So that's the goal here. So why this approach is better, we believe? It's non-invasive. So what is invasive is only navigating the burning catheter at the very end. The whole interrogation now is offline. It's non-invasive. And then the delivery of the actual ablation is very swift and precise because we have a target. The lesions we expect to be much smaller. And then there would be improved tolerance for the therapy and, of course, reduced complications because the patient is not being there probed with this catheter. And there are often perforations and other complications. So that's our approach. Now, let me tell you how we build these models. So this is a patient that has an infarct right here. And then we segment out the MRI, and we construct the overall geometry of the heart. We also segment out the infarct and that remodeled zone around that. And you can see them here. We put all that together, and you get a patient heart with the specific distribution of the infarct and the surrounding areas. And then, the heart consists of cells that are arranged in these fiber-like arrays. This is actually very important functionally because it helps with contraction. They kind of form these spiraling pathways, the fibers. And this is actually very good for contraction because, you know, when you do laundry and you wring the laundry, you do that. And so that's how the fibers are arranged to help with the pushing of the blood out of the main chambers of the heart. So they are important not only for the contraction, but for the electrical functioning of the heart. And so we need to incorporate those in the model. Well, there is no way to get that from the patient's scan. There is no modality which will allow us to do that. So we have developed this way of estimating the fiber orientations in the heart of the patient. And we use several approaches, but one of them is shown here. When you have a human heart, which is an atlas, and you basically take your atlas and morph it onto the patient geometry, and then this transformation carries out the fiber orientation, and you get an estimate of the fiber orientation. So now we have the geometrical model, and then you can think of the geometrical model, this patient-specific geometrical model, as a scaffolding in our virtual heart. That's the scaffolding. That's the geometry. And now we populate this scaffold with cells, and each of them have proteins and other cellular functions. This is, there are ionic channel. There is calcium cycling in the cell. So that's what I meant by the fact that our models incorporate from molecular to the whole heart. So we put this in the model. We have properties at the tissue level, how the cells connect. We put that all in the model. We have different proteins in the different regions, some are remodeled when they are around the infarct, so we incorporate that. So you can think of, if a patient heart is built in that way, you can think of it like as a Google heart. You can look at it from above, but you can also zoom down to the cellular level. Maybe you can change a protein. For instance, if you have genetic information, you can change certain things, and then you can zoom out and see how little changes at the molecular level lead to big changes on the level of the whole heart. So that's the conceptual, that's our simulation environment. So that's how we simulate that. And so I want to show you here, so what I'm going to show you is an experiment in which a pig, so this is going to be a pig heart, in vivo pig heart. We are going to, you do first animal experiments before you do it in the people. So that's, I'm going to show you a pig in which we reconstructed the pig from the in vivo MRI scan, and then we evaluated the arrhythmia, and then we wanted to see whether we can predict where to ablate. So you can see this is the pig MRI, you can see the infarct right here. And then we reconstructed the model has the scar and this kind of grayish zone, semi-viable around it. And here is the arrhythmia in this. So it's not very much on the outside of the heart, but the inside, on the inner surface, you can see the spiraling wave. And that's an arrhythmia that we calculated. We know where it is. So on the right ventricular side of the septum, septum is the separating wall between the two chambers. So we know what the arrhythmia is. And in the experiment, they did some measurements, and then they ablated this heart. And you can see, again, those are the tips of the catheter. They did a lot of burns. And you can see here they are. And so we reconstructed these burns in the model. And those are the actual lesions around the catheter tips. And so those burns succeeded in terminating the arrhythmia. So our first experiment is, if it succeeded here in the experiment, those burns, if we put them in our model, they should also succeed if our model is predictive. So we put them in the model now, and indeed the arrhythmia terminated. So that was, so what the success in the experiment, we reproduced it in the model. So first check, we can do that. Now, we said, well, look at those lesions. Look how big they are. And so we predicted where would be the best place to burn. See how much smaller they are, much, much smaller. And when we put those lesions, you can see we also succeeded. So you can do it. And this is automatic. The software automatically decides what's an optimal ablation target. And then we moved, so we did a series of animal experiments. So these are human hearts. So these are patients. And we reconstructed their infarcts and the geometries. And you can see the infarcts here. And here is one patient. And here is an arrhythmia in this patient. OK, so it's kind of two spirals. And what we did is we automatically placed the ablation lesion. This is what we thought needs to be burned. And when you place that, you can never have an arrhythmia anymore. It tries to form but cannot. We burned the critical point. So these patients were already ablated. So when we did this, we were blind to the clinical outcome. And then we predicted that this will be successful if you place it here. And then once we completed the project, we were given the clinical data. And you can see those are the burns everywhere here. See, we are within but much smaller. OK, so that's our prediction. So we nailed it. Another patient is, here is an arrhythmia in this patient. And you can see the burn was actually fairly small up here. You can see dot, 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 dot. Here is our prediction, still smaller right here. Again, automatically placed there. This is another patient. So we predicted you need to burn here. You can see they burn from here to here. All that's the left ventricle, this chamber. You can see the burns go from top to bottom. Ours is much smaller. So so this is, we are very, very excited about that. And as Igor mentioned, I received the NIH Director's Pioneer Award for that, for this sort of this vision of where we are going. And so the NIH asked us, for all the people, the project that received the Pioneer Award, they asked us to make something to promote the project. So it can be a song, can be interpretive dance, if you will, and or movie or whatever. So my lab made an infomercial. So this is an infomercial. It's done in-house, so, you know, it's done by my students. And so I want you to...
Welcome to Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, Maryland. Today, we're going to hear the story of two patients with a cardiac arrhythmia. Mel will receive the conventional EP treatment. Kelly will get the pioneering new virtual EP treatment. In Mel's case, the doctor takes invasive measurements to map sites of scar tissue that need to be burned, a process called ablation. It's time-consuming, it's difficult, and the measurements give limited information.
There's got to be a better way.
There is a better way.
The first step of VEPL is an MRI scan to non-invasively capture images of Kelly's heart. For now, she's free to go about her day. Meanwhile, the MRI images are beamed to the state-of-the-art computational cardiology lab, where our team of super scientists will use supercomputers to construct a detailed virtual copy of Kelly's heart. The virtual heart will be used to plan a personalized therapy to cure Kelly's arrhythmia. Thanks to this rigorous virtual analysis, Kelly's doctor can ablate with confidence and laser-like precision, resulting in a quicker, more precise procedure. In the end, Kelly and Mel are both cured of their arrhythmias, but for Mel, it was a long and difficult day.
There's got to be a better way.
There is a better way.
That's, yes. So they did it without me. I actually went on a trek in the Himalayas, and they took my scene before they started even doing the video. And then when I returned, it was done. So this was the first project that I wanted to talk to you about. So we're also working on risk stratification for patients who have myocardial infarction, the infarct. What ends up happening is when a person gets a heart attack and develops an infarct, typically they will get a defibrillator implanted. This decision is based on one criterion. If the ejection fraction of the left ventricle is less than 35%. So the ejection fraction is the amount of blood that is pumped out of the chamber. So a decision whether a person should receive a defibrillator, which is shocks the heart to terminate an arrhythmia. So a decision for an electrical problem is made on the basis of a mechanical parameter. So, and it is a global function parameter, 35%. So anybody who has a left ventricular ejection fraction below 35% is gonna get a defibrillator. Now, what does this result into? Only 5% of the patients who have defibrillators implanted receive, on an annual basis, appropriate device therapy, appropriate shock. That means only 5% of these patients have an arrhythmia annually. So the rest have defibrillators. Sometimes they get inappropriate shocks. There is component malfunction. There is also infections. So these patients are subjected to risks without deriving any health benefit. In addition, that criterion misses many at-risk patients. They might have 40-something ejection fraction. As a matter of fact, that constitutes the largest amount of people who are going to die of sudden cardiac death, that missed number. So you can see how imprecise we are in stratifying patients for arrhythmia risk. And what we want to do is we want to develop a better approach for doing that. And we have exactly the same procedure. The patient comes in, scanned, MRI, we do image processing, and then we simulate. But instead of before, we would tell the physician where to burn. Here, all what we are saying is, this patient will develop an arrhythmia and that one will not. So we are having a different criterion than this single number. So we did 41 patients. We constructed the heart. This is a huge project. We constructed the hearts of 41 patients, did simulations for these patients. All of these patients have infarction and they have defibrillators implanted. In some of them, they did a clinical study in which they probed the functioning of the heart to have a more precise clinical way of determining that. So there is this information also available. In addition to that, the patients were followed for 5-6 years. So we know, well, we don't, but the doctors know whether they had an arrhythmia and whether the defibrillator has discharged. Now, for us, this information was not provided to us. We just got the images. And so we are going to predict whether these patients will have an arrhythmia or not. And at the end, we will compare with the clinical outcome. So in some patients, you can see the this is like, it's called an isochrone map. And you can see that it doesn't curl on itself. So the wave goes through, and that's that. Fine. These patients, although they have infarcts, they did not develop arrhythmia. The simulations did not predict they will develop an arrhythmia. In others, you can see the wavefront turning on itself. They have spirals. They have arrhythmia. So in these, we predicted they will have an arrhythmia. And so here is, in all patients, here is the sort of the evaluation of our methodology. You can have see how high. We have a very high sensitivity. We have a very high positive and negative predictive value, overall accuracy of 74%. And this is called a Kaplan-Meier survival curve. And it shows that we can predict negative is separate from positive. We can tell which will have an arrhythmia and which will have not. The most exciting is this slide. So when they showed me this picture, I really wanted to like hug and kiss this slide. This is amazing because this is the clinical test. The clinical test did not predict well how many patients will survive, how many patients are going to die. We did. So we missed one patient. So if we predicted everything correctly, this will be a straight line. We missed one patient only. So our result is way, way better than the clinical test. And then there are some numbers, sorry to compare right here, the sensitivity of our test compared to the clinical test, the specificity, the positive predictive, the negative predictive value, and the overall accuracy, much, much better. So we did that in 41 patients. We are writing the paper right now. We are extremely excited about that. So we can use it. This is a real, we have constructed a lot of hearts, and we run those are simulations that run for days to determine that. But you can see, despite that, we are able to have a significant number to do statistics and then to predict what is the overall accuracy. So again, very, very happy that this is progressing so well. And now I want to talk about the last project, atrial fibrillation. So atrial fibrillation is an arrhythmia in the upper chambers. Now, we talked about the lower chambers. Now, the arrhythmias in the lower chambers are little. Arrhythmias in the upper chambers are not. The atrial fibrillation is the most common arrhythmia in the human. And as the population ages, a lot of people are getting, will be getting and will continue to be getting these arrhythmias. So there is a lot of, for the ventricular arrhythmia, people just put defibrillators because that's life-saving. For these, there are more opportunities for tailored treatment and so forth because it's not little. It's just that there is a, the probability of stroke is high. But, and it's of course an unpleasant condition, but it's not little. So we want to do human also predictions in these patients. What is the best therapy for these? And we are particularly focusing on patients that have fibrosis. So fibrosis is like the scar, but not as deep as in the infarct, a little bit more distributed. And these are human atria. We collaborate with a group in the University of Bordeaux, and they gave us these images from their patients. The green is the fibrotic change. So these hearts are remodeled. They have fibrosis. And so that was from the MRI scan. They're able to discern the fibrotic remodeling. And so we use these atrial models to see what is the dynamics of the arrhythmia and then predict what is the best way to ablate. And so we are trying first to understand in these patients and then deliver best therapy. So this is us reconstructing the model. You can see it's three-dimensional. They are thin walls, but nonetheless, we have three-dimensional. And you can see here a... this is how it looks in a patient. This is one of the patient hearts. You can see here an arrhythmia, sort of a... That's called atrial fibrillation. So you have a lot of wavefronts kind of in a somewhat chaotic way. But if you focus right here, there is one pink dot that's going around. And we put this pink dot there to highlight the fact that one of these spirals is actually quite persistent. It's staying there, going back and forth, but staying in this fairly confined location. So this is called a reentrant driver or persistent organizing center. And I want to... So we follow the trajectory, and we... where it goes. And this is shown here together with the fibrosis. It's another patient right here. It's a different patient. You can see another persistent rotor. We find that in patients, there are 2 to 5 of these persistent ones. And if you plot the trajectory, and then we can superimpose it with the fibrosis. So when you look at that, you can't tell really why are they sustained here or here. It's not very clear. So what we wanted to do is take a closer look. So we kind of took this region, and you can see the same movie here. We are just plotting this pink dot jumping from fibrotic region to fibrotic region, and you can see it kind of stays at the edges of fibrosis, but doesn't go in other fibrotic region, just stays there. So then we thought maybe that some of these fibrotic regions are actually act as attractors, like kind of try to anchor these organizing centers. So we decided to do, so they are close to these boundaries of fibrotic tissue, and we wanted to do, as engineers, a quantitative characterization. Can you have like a certain distribution that is more likely to organize the electrical activity like that? So we tried to quantitatively characterize the fibrosis. And so we did two metrics, density, which is a proportion of fibrotic tissue by volume. You take a kernel and move it through the atria and construct these maps of density. And then we did also a clustering. There is an autocorrelation function called Moran size, so we did that. But what we are trying to, these maps show that when you put everything together, it turns out, so this is the density, that's the clustering. And you can see these little pink dots stay in a particular density and particular clustering. What this tells us is that there is something about this fibrotic distribution, certain distribution that has this specific density and this specific clustering that has these attractive properties. And when we plotted all the fibrotic tissue that has these properties, turns out that not only our persistent rotating wave, but all the other waves are also, even the transient ones, are very attracted to these regions. So this is very important, because coming up with some sort of a idea when a physician can look only at the map of fibrosis, can say, run these very simple statistics, and then there will be a set of places that they can target for ablation. Now we want to do modeling to be more specific, but it can be done on the fly. This prediction can be done on the fly, and then we know which parts of the atria are more attractive than the others. So you can see here, this is one of these drivers, and then we actually ablated it. We burnt it, and you can see here, we burnt it, and then we try to induce arrhythmia all the time, but we cannot. Basically, we were able to eliminate it based on knowing where that driver is in these specific parts of the fibrotic region. So we got no arrhythmia. So this is our approach that we are taking to targeted ablation in the atria, where we are looking at what is the fibrosis distribution, how the arrhythmia organizes, and then targeting these organizing centers with the burns. So what are the new ideas here in this whole presentation? It's very important to get personalized information about the patient's heart, about the distribution of the scar. whether it's the fibrosis in the upper chambers or whether it's the infarct scar, the personal distribution, the morphology of this remodeled region is very, very important. So we are using these scans to construct the scaffolding of the heart. And then we exploit the link between the structural remodeling that occurs in the diseased heart and the arrhythmia, the rhythm dysfunction. We exploit that link so we can predict the optimal personalized arrhythmia treatment. So that's the big picture. Every patient has a virtual heart. You look at the arrhythmia, you predict what's the best treatment scenario. We believe that that's a transformative approach that brings computational modeling of individual heart dysfunction to the clinic for guidance of therapies. And we hope that it could be a paradigm shift in cardiac patient care should that be translated to the clinic. And I hope I'm alive to see that happen. So virtual heart for every patient. Those are the grants that support me. The The NIH Director's Pioneer Award has been wonderful because there is no, basically you're very free to do whatever you want and allows us, this is a high risk, high reward project, so you can take risks and not be afraid that you may not succeed. Again, I'm very enthusiastic about it. My enthusiasm, of course, does not mean that we're going to succeed necessarily, but I do hope that we are able to make a difference one day. And a lot of collaborators that have worked with me on these projects, and then again, my lab. So thank you very much for your attention.
Questions, please.
How close do you think your research is to being adopted as a common practice?
So adoption to common practice follows clinical trials. So the next question is, are you doing clinical trials, right? We have a few centers in which we have passed an IRB. And we had one patient enrolled, and we did one. And it's you have to test a lot of the things. So for instance, what we learned from this one patient is that when you give the physician where to ablate, they have to render that together with their system. And that registration is very important. We didn't realize, because then you can misalign it, and then it doesn't go to. So things like this have to be worked out. But we have passed an IRB in a few places. Another confounding factor is that turns out that a lot of these patients also have defibrillators implanted already for the ventricular ones. And for those, when you take an MRI scan, it leaves a shadow. And so now we learn how to reconstruct hearts, although they have a shadow, how to interpolate and so forth, so we can include a larger patient population. But we are, so we would be great to have to complete some clinical trials in the next few years. So that's my goal, hopefully. Yeah. To the what functions?
Arterial.
For the arterial, yes. So we do not do blood flow per se. So there are people who work on computational fluid dynamics that specialize in that. For instance, I know of people who can even predict whether a blood vessel will have an aneurysm, or the blood vessel is, you can do from the way the flow is, you can predict how much the narrowing is and whether this patient needs a stent. We do not do that. For us, the infarct is the result of the event that happens in the blood vessel. And then it.
There's something I heard of that similar aspect.
Exactly, yes.
Etron, that you actually measure the flow in your fingers.
Right.
And
they okay.
You about your.
Right, right. Actually, we have a project in which the same device is used to measure whether there are alterations in the mechanical pulse, and that can predict dysfunction as well. So there is a lot of these newer methodologies to do that. Our goal, ultimately, I would see that, because our model is, what I'm presenting to you today is only electrical function. I also have a research avenue on the mechanics, which is not as developed. So my hope is that we combine the electrics with the mechanics, contraction of the heart, and then we combine that with the blood flow, ultimately.
Yeah. The main guy working with the fingers
Baltimore has a lot of very good researchers.
Excuse me. So earlier, as mentioned in the presentation, the phrase supercomputer technology.
That's, and yes, my students.
Can you talk a little bit about that? What kind of computational horsepower do you need?
So it is, we have a cluster of, basically, we use it. So there are several, we all the time, you know, whatever we are given, we will fill it up, of course. So I'm part of the Institute for Computational Medicine. The Institute has its own cluster. And then the undergraduate campus at Hopkins has a big cluster, so we use that as well. And right now, Maryland is building a huge computational facility that will involve Hopkins, University of Maryland. So everybody, we are so excited we are getting like access there. So we use about, for a simulation, we would use, depends, but you know, like 64 processors or something like that. It's parallel, the code is parallel. If we have more, we'll use more. Sometimes it's really difficult to get the number of processors that you need for a simulation, we wait. But yeah, it's parallel code, it's optimized. So yeah, state of the art, I would say.
Two questions. One with the ventricular arrhythmias, can you distinguish between an epicardial and an endocardial site?
Yeah.
Because that is a big difference as to the success rate.
So, normally, in the clinic, there is both endocardial approach for ablation and an epicardial approach. So in the endocardial, basically, the catheter goes through a vein and inside the chamber of the heart and then delivers a burn from there. In the epicardial, they go through a blood vessel on the outside and reach the epicardium that way. Some arrhythmias are, the organizing center is on the endocardium. For some, it's on epicardium. For some, you cannot see it. Neither on the endocardium nor on the epicardium, it's in the middle. And we can see it because it's in the model, but the physician cannot. So it can be any. And in our prediction, it's three-dimensional. So we basically predict where to ablate, and it can be anywhere. Now, let's say we predict to ablate somewhere in the middle, and it might be difficult to access it. We can immediately say, okay, if you access it from here and you cannot reach the whole area that needs to be reached, if you burn half of it, what would be the next burn, right? So we can rerun the simulation and say, okay, if you cannot reach this place, what would be the next best? So we can do that on the fly, basically. So for us, it doesn't matter where what's endo, epi, mid, it's all okay.
And with the atrial fibrillation arrhythmia, since the majority of the burns that are made are in the pulmonary veins, it looked like your fibrotic tissues from Bordeaux were really for
pulmonary veins is an ablation mostly for paroxysmal atrial fibrillation. So that's atrial fibrillation that lasts for a while, then disappears, then that comes again. As the atrial fibrillation progresses and progresses, becomes persistent. And typically in patients with persistent pulmonary veins they ablate them anyways, but they do not, that does not terminate the arrhythmia. Particularly patients that have fibrosis, it's very pulmonary. There's always some other ablation needs to be done in addition to the pulmonary veins. So the pulmonary veins take care of focal sources that arise in the pulmonary veins. The rest of the substrate, which is the fibrotic tissue, needs to be taken care of somehow. So that's where we come. That's the hard part. They will ablate the pulmonary veins no matter what. The rest is where do you predict the ablation to be. Yeah?
Does this research, I'm wondering if it also is leading to suggestions that people are doing, like ISMIS, the tool you use for the ablation, or maybe even the implanted defibrillators, how to better design those to be more effective?
So we did a research. I'm answering the second part of your question first. So we did a research on children with congenital heart disease, and some of these, actually after the correction of the whatever the congenital defect is, there is scarring from the surgery, and these kids develop arrhythmias. And they get defibrillators implanted. Now, in a little child's body, it's very hard to put a defibrillator. They are made for adults, and there is no pediatric defibrillator. So in these little, even a baby, the same defibrillator is implanted as in an adult. And where you put the defibrillator is actually important, since the shock is delivered between that can and a catheter. And so it can be this way or this way. And one can result in more successful shocks and the other not. And so we have a paper in which we use the modeling, and we created a model of the whole torso and the congenital heart defect in that patient. And we put different locations of the defibrillator and predicted which one would be the best for this child. So we did that as well. I'm not showing it because it's not, you know, I have a limited time. But we did that. So, you know, this is one of the things we are very interested in. For the first project where we are looking at where the isthmus to ablate, so the isthmus is more of a clinical term that comes from the fact that for a very long time, the scar was, the arrhythmia associated with the scar was viewed as arising from the fact that you have a channel in the scar and it's going to propagate like that. Actually, in three dimensions, it's more complicated. So this is an isthmus that goes between two parts of the scar and it goes around, and they are looking for an exit site in the isthmus and burn, and that works. But actually, it's more complicated that in three dimensions, you might have an isthmus, but you have other parts that also remodel through that can sustain. So part of when, like in one of my hearts, it was actually ablated, isthmus was ablated, the other was more than that, other things. So isthmus is part of it. And we predict it automatically, whether it's isthmus or not, we predict automatically where the burn should be.
So I have a question.
Yes.
So since decoding human genome, so we dropped in price from, I don't know, whatever.
Yeah, it's very cheap now. Yeah.
$100 million or more for pure genome now to under $1,000.
Yeah.
And pretty soon we will all have probably our genome sequenced. So now I have the question, how much does it cost to build a personalized model of the heart in terms of arrhythmia? And, how many of us will actually have to have a model like that?
The hope is that...
For you, Igor.
Yeah, Igor. friends. We'll build yours. All my students went and got their hearts scanned. And then so we have models of all my students. And not only that, they printed them on the three-dimensional printer. So each of them has their own heart. And, so we can print your heart. our hope is that this becomes a routine tool in the clinical electrophysiology lab. So there is everybody who comes for a procedure would have that. This is a very good question because I also have a company that started and they did some market analysis, and I actually don't know the exact numbers, but there needs to be a reimbursement code for that. So as long as we have something that, you know, can be taken care of in that way, we hope that it would be not more expensive than, much cheaper than we are hoping, than like an MRI or something like that. So again, we will see is the answer.
Hi. Given the research that you've done in the feasibility study that you showed, I understand the need for this particular kind of research, but can you speak a little bit more on a personal level as to why you decided to make this your charge and why you've pursued this?
I've always worked on computational biology, and it is a really interesting field because computational biology of the heart, what we are looking at is sort of dissecting mechanisms. Why this arises, you are able to pull things away and make conclusions why things occur. And it's been really interesting. But once we were able to do these things, there is something so exciting about being able to make a difference in the clinic. And what is so exciting is that when you talk to clinicians, a tiny little contribution makes huge impact. So it was so natural to me once we developed these tools to say, I have looked at mechanisms of arrhythmias for many, many years. So what can I do with them to make people's lives better? It is extraordinarily satisfying from that perspective. And again, this is a vision that I hope, happens sometimes in the future. It's also very exciting from another perspective. Computational simulations of the heart. This is a basic science discipline. To take something that's basic science and translate it and say, I'm taking this that's been for years used only for basic science and I'm putting it in the clinic is also like it's a fundamental leap towards something new. I think computational modeling has a lot to offer in the clinic. I think it's going to usher in a plethora of new approaches. I do believe in that. So to me, it's very exciting to be one of the pioneers doing that.
Last question.
Oh. I'm impressed by all of this, but particularly by two things that have been running through my head. I was years ago in the early 70s was working with the Joint Center for Radiation Therapy and was on the faculty up at MIT. And the not only am I impressed with the way, obviously, computers have multiplied the capabilities, but the way that doctors are willing to accept input from engineers in a way that they never were in the old days. I remember my colleague, Dick Seidel and I, we were trying to convince the radiation therapists that instead of having the doctor sit down with a PDPA computer and say, well, I'm gonna put the beam here and there and there, that there was I proposed that they could do, instead of a repeated analysis where the doctor thought up the treatment, they could do treatment synthesis and they could trace out on a scan, here's a radiosensitive structure, the spine, here's the tumor, here's right. The kidneys. We don't want to burn these things out. We need at least this many rads to make a therapeutic mm-hmm, dose mm-hmm. at the tumor, but we don't want it to be above this. And then let the computer solve the problem backwards and propose dynamically drive the beam around. Over Christmas vacation, Dick Seidel and I wrote a little prototype program to do this stuff. And we said, okay, here are the different densities of the lungs and so forth. The doctors said, no, we calculate everything as the density of water, unit density. And we said, well, you know the beam is going through ear here and it's going through bone there. And the doctors said, we don't care. We can't calculate it if we use different densities. So we assume the entire body is the density of water. And they would prefer to do it wrong where they could get a number than to do it approximately right and not get a number. And so this change in attitude is just incredible.
Yeah, well, I don't know whether it is a full change of attitude. Some people are more receptive than others. I am at Hopkins, and doctors there are definitely more receptive than, you know, a regular clinic that you would go that does more routine stuff, that doesn't have so much clinical research. So there are categories of doctors that are very excited about what I do. There are others that would look at me and go, this can't be, or something like that. On the other hand, though, I have to say that reaching physicians, the ability to convince physicians of what you're doing, to accept what you're doing, has required of me to abandon my language entirely. I never show equations. I never talk about how you solve anything. I never talk about what goes into it. You talk conceptual. You talk vision. You talk about the difference it's going to make. I go now to more clinical meetings. I stopped going to engineering meetings or physics I go to clinical meetings. And being there together with the clinicians, speaking their language, I think that's what made it the difference for me. You know, they cannot come to me. I have to go to them. I have to speak their language. That's what I learned.
Okay. Well, I think we should conclude it because we do have some time afterwards. We can talk afterwards, but let me finish on this wonderful note. And I think it's really great that engineering came to clinical EP lab. Let's thank our wonderful speaker and this is a small gift token of
thank
our appreciation.
Thank you, Igor. Thank you. Thank you very much. This is really fun. Thank you.
And now we have a small reception outside where we can ask more questions.